Welcome to the REI Diamond Interview, your source for real estate investment jewels of wisdom with Dan Breslin.
Welcome to the REI Diamond Show with David Pistolsky on crowdfunding. I'm Dan Breslin, host of the REI Diamond Show, and each week I invite a high-caliber performer to share their unique experience as it relates to real estate investing. This week's guest is David Pistolsky of Gerhardt Law. On this episode, we are going to talk about the red-hot topic of crowdfunding and the opportunity it provides to you as a real estate investor. David is an intellectual property attorney and an expert in patents, trademarks, and copyrights, as well as crowdfunding. So this episode promises to be very interesting as a new wave of real estate capital has been created and becoming available through these crowdfunding sources. Welcome to the show, David.
Thank you, Dan. Thanks for having me. Excited to be here.
Appreciate that. So let's just get a little bit of a background so everybody knows who you are, David. Just give us the 5-minute, you know, reader digest of sort of where you came from, what you do now, and how that relates to the real estate investing community.
Excellent. As you mentioned, I'm an intellectual property and patent attorney. I've been an attorney for about 17 years. I started my career at one of the largest law firms in the world, and now I'm probably at one of the smallest law firms that I've ever been at. And so that 17-year journey has really been quite exciting. It has really taught me that the type of client and the sweet spot that I'm looking to assist people in is the startup or the entrepreneur, the emerging company, the company that's about to go global. So it's taken me about 17 years to realize that through helping these types of companies protect their intellectual property. So intellectual property being either a patent or a trademark or a copyright or a trade secret. And so, of course, part of the journey of any entrepreneur is that they usually need some type of funding to get their venture off the ground. One of the hottest ways to do that today, or at least since 2009, has been crowdfunding. And so recognizing this opportunity about 7 or 8 years ago, I began a quest of public speaking on crowdfunding because there were unique intellectual property issues related to crowdfunding that I wanted people to understand, that I wanted the inventors and the entrepreneurs and the small business to understand that it's not just, oh, put your project online and you get money, or put your potential real estate opportunity and get money, or I'm an investor and I now want to invest in a piece of property. What does that mean for me? So there's unique legal and intellectual property considerations that I felt it my duty to educate and empower people on. So a few years ago, I started doing that. And as the real estate industry realized that crowdfunding is a phenomenal opportunity for them as well, I slowly began to create a little niche practice for those types of clients. So anybody from the real estate investor to the person or to the entity or to the company that actually is selling the property or, you know, looking for investment. So both sides of the coin, say, so the investor as well as the issuer. So yeah, so that's kind of what brought me here today. I think it's an exciting time for crowdfunding in general, and even more exciting time for the real estate industry. Pretty amazing area to be involved in, but it comes with pitfalls, and I think that's what today is about. It's kind of understanding what the pitfalls are and being prepared. So from a, you know, legal and business perspective, as well as from an intellectual property perspective.
Nice. I think it would be helpful to me and the listeners if you could just describe the origination and the process, or the progress rather, of how crowdfunding developed. I mean, you know, how did we get to where it's at today, and why did this start and where did this start? Because there were some fundamental changes in 2009, I believe, that took effect that really opened the door for this type of funding, correct?
Yes. Yeah, no, excellent point. So crowdfunding actually has been around for, you know, hundreds of years. They say the first event of crowdfunding on record was actually the funding to erect the Statue of Liberty. So here right. came the Statue of Liberty, right. this gift from France. It comes to New York City. It comes in pieces. New York City realizes, oh my God, we have no money to erect it. And so what does New York do? They publish in their papers saying, can you give us a few cents or even a dollar to help the cause to erect it? And that's what people did. People, out of the kindness of their hearts, in order to see this gift erected, gave a dollar or 50 cents or whatever the amount of money was then. And so that really is crowdfunding. So it's the funding of a project by a crowd. And so, you know, traditionally, this is done for altruistic reasons, right? People want to help to see another person's project come to life. People want to share in the success of other people, or people want to maybe see and own a product before anybody else. And so it really, really has been around for a long time, but really became popular in 2008-ish when Kickstarter came out. That was one of the first major crowdfunding sites, where if you had a potential product that you wanted to get on the market and you wanted to kind of test the market to see if people liked your product, you would offer the product for a pre-sale. And so the product maybe wasn't done yet, but you would say to people, hey, I need $20,000 to finish production on the product. And if you want, you can get in on this product by helping me achieve that 20,000 goal. And so people would give, you know, up to, you know, thousands of dollars, but as little as a dollar, to help projects get off the ground. And in exchange, they were either getting a thank you, a shirt, a button, whatever, or they were getting the actual product once it was made. And so this was great. This was a phenomenal way for startups and entrepreneurs to really see their projects come to life. At the exact same time this is happening, there is the world of venture capital. And so what is the world of venture capital? But kind of like a crowdfunding. So the difference being that people, i.e. the venture capitalists, are investing in companies. In exchange, they're getting a security interest in that company. So a little bit different. They're giving money not for a button or a t-shirt or a product, but they're giving money for getting equity in a company. So that's great. And so that was happening at the exact same time that Kickstarter was going on. So we have what we call the reward-based crowdfunding sites like Kickstarter. And then we had the venture capital world, which was, you know, private citizens giving money to people or giving money to companies in exchange for an equity interest. It was bound to happen around 2010-ish or 2011-ish that there was going to be a marriage between the two. It only makes sense that the SEC was going to get involved, the Securities and Exchange Commission was going to get involved, and they said, hey, let's actually take elements of the reward-based crowdfunding system, where people, normal everyday citizens who are not venture capitalists, who don't have net worths of over $1 million and don't make a lot of money but still want to help, let's give them that opportunity to potentially invest in somebody's company. So give money, as small as it is, and get an interest, an equity interest in a company. So again, not a t-shirt or anything like that, not a venture capitalist, this time a regular citizen, and let's open that opportunity up. And so that's exactly what the SEC did with the help of President Obama. They created the Jobs Act, as we know it, which is the Jumpstart Our Business Startup Act. Jumpstart Our Business Startup Act. And so President Obama said, we're now going to make crowdfunding, this idea of equity crowdfunding, open to anybody, not just venture capitalists, right? We're going to allow the normal everyday citizen to crowdfund, not just for rewards, but for an equitable interest in another company. This is huge. Like, this is a phenomenal time of ever to be involved in this equitable interest world of giving money to people and potentially sharing in their opportunity. So now you don't have to be a venture capitalist. You can be a private citizen who can now purchase an interest in another company. And so that's kind of like the evolution of crowdfunding. We went from reward-based crowdfunding to equity-based crowdfunding that was reserved just for a venture capitalist, a private gated community. And now with the passing of the Jobs Act and a few of the different titles under the Jobs Act, crowdfunding is now for everybody. You don't have to be worth $1 million in order to invest in somebody's opportunity.
Got it.
That was a lot of information, but that's kind of the whole gamut of crowdfunding. So you can either do the reward or you can do the equity. And then, of course, the real estate comes into it.
And how much different is this? Because when, you know, corporations were put together and they issue 500,000 shares, however many shares, in a sense, that's a crowdfunding deal too, correct?
Yeah, if you want to think of it like that, sure. I mean, if at the end of the day, crowdfunding really is people that you don't know sharing in a company's success. And so, yes, the world of you know issuing shares and issuing stocks in a company, that is essentially crowdfunding. Now it's privatized, right? So now there is now an intermediary, a platform, just like Kickstarter. Let's say it's called GoFundMe, which is one of the more popular ones. So instead of like doing a IPO, basically a public offering, instead you would go to these intermediary sites like GoFundMe. You would list your opportunity as an issuer, saying, I'm looking for 500 investors, or I'm looking for 500 shareholders, to use your comparison. And so that portal will then reach out to their investment community, their investor community, and say, hey, we have this new opportunity. They're looking for 500 investors for a specific amount of money to come in. Do you want a piece of this company? Do you want an equitable portion of this company? So, yeah, it's very similar to that.
Got it. So let's talk about how it is for real estate investors. I mean, are we talking about, you know, one of these crowdfunding outfits that deals with, you know, realty shares, for example? Are they typically, David, going to be looking for a fixed rate of return, you know, in a form of interest that maybe just a 10 or 9% or a higher rate? Or do these crowdfunding sites typically expect a preferred return in addition to some portion of the equity of the project? Can you give me maybe some examples of what real estate investors could look for, would maybe believe they'd have a good idea if they stumbled upon one of these crowdfunding opportunities to put one of their deals to work?
Yeah, so that's a pretty loaded question, and that's because when the real estate crowdfunding community was born, as you can imagine, with every new opportunity, there are, you know, 50 to 100 sites that are specifically geared to the real estate crowdfunding industry. So really, the advice to investors is to do your due diligence. And so, I mean, you'd have to do that anyway, right? So if you were potentially looking for a piece of property to invest in, you would do your due diligence. So now you have to do your due diligence in the crowdfunding portals that you want to work with. And so different crowdfunding portals, different real estate crowdfunding portals, offer different types of investment opportunities to real estate investors. Some may offer a interest in a community, or some may offer an interest in a high rise, or some may offer interest in a private home. As you can imagine, the rate of return is different. The amount of the investment becomes different, right? And so if you look at it from that angle, it really is a matter of kind of what you are looking for as an investor and what you want to get out of it. And so there are sites where you can invest as little as, you know, $25,000 and see an annual return between, you know, 6 and 12%. And there are sites where it's a little bit higher and lower on both ends. It really all depends on what is your, you know, kind of niche as an investor, as a real estate investor. Everybody has their own specialty, right? Some people want to invest in private homes or high rises or shopping centers. And so there is a real estate crowdfunding site or portal for all of these niches. And so it really all depends. And it's actually pretty interesting due diligence to do, because it's almost like shopping online, right? So you go to these portals and the opportunity, i.e. the property, the actual real estate property, is there for you to peruse, right? So instead of visiting it, you are visiting it online. So there's really, these sites really run the gamut. I can't tell you how niche they get. Like, for instance, there's a site that just offers a real estate opportunity in like old age homes. It depends on kind of what you're looking for in terms of how much money you're willing to invest and kind of what you're looking for the rate of return. But there's enough data out there in the real estate crowdfunding world to really do your due diligence to see what site gives the best rate of return and what site gives the minimum, what site has the lowest minimum investment and what site has the largest minimum investment. It's really a whole new world, especially for the new real estate investor. They traditionally may have invested $100,000 or up in a piece of property, and now they don't have to do that. They can diversify their investment between a few properties on the same site. So there's a lot of different options for sure.
It sounds like it gets complex relatively fast, David. Is there any aggregator of the information, or like you have an investment advisor for the stock world, is there some other person of that nature who's maybe on the way, is developing into the market at this point, who would help an investor, say, come with suppose we had somebody with $500,000 in an IRA, and they want to separate that and diversify that. Is there an advisor of this specialty out there that could help somebody with
that? Dan, excellent question. Unfortunately, there isn't. And this is kind of what we saw happen on the reward-based side. There are, you know, let's say there are 50 to 100 real estate crowdfunding sites. There are about 600 to 700 reward-based sites. And there still isn't one definitive aggregator of all these sites, kind of like a Standard & Poor's, kind of ratings manual of crowdfunding sites. It does not exist. And you're right. It can get really complex because you want to be able to work with the right portal, right? The one or two saving graces are this. One, there are a lot of published reports out there as to what real estate crowdfunding sites are doing in the past year. So there's a lot of like public information here. So if you remember, this is all SEC regulated, right? This is all Security and Exchange Commission regulated, which means that the portal, as well as the issuer that's issuing the property, that's issuing the equity in the property, they must abide by SEC disclosures. So everything is public. Every piece of information you want to find on a real estate portal or on the property that's posted on the real estate portal is completely disclosed to everyone because that's what the SEC mandates, right? They are mandating financial disclosures. They are mandating that the person who owns the property that wants to put the property up for some type of equitable ownership, that they have to have their disclosures in, that the company that's representing the old age home that wants to put the old age home on the portal, that they also have their disclosures, that they've been audited. And so that is a saving grace, that if you actually know where to find this information, then you will be able to do some good due diligence. The problem is, where do you go to do the due diligence? Unfortunately, no. There's not a definitive source. However, there are reports. There's the 2015 crowdfunding real estate report that was like, it's kind of, it comes out every year. It's like an aggregate of like all the sites, how much money has been made, what is the growth rate, how fast is the segment growing, how much capital, how much market share each country has in the real estate industry. So there are some definitive sources that you can look to, but at the end of the day, there's still not this idea that you have to, you know, do your own due diligence, and there isn't any one advisor that can help you. There are what we call crowdfunding experts, you know, people that have an interested kind of take in the industry. You know, different people representing different verticals that can make the real estate crowdfunding experience goes smoother for an investor. So like some banks have gotten involved in this, some mortgage brokers have gotten involved in this, some investment analysis have gotten involved in this. Everybody has their own product that they're looking at the real estate industry and they're trying to, you know, cull all the disclosures that have been made so that when the investor comes, they know what they're getting into. And then the portal itself provides education as well to the investor. But no, there's not one definitive source. It's unfortunately, there's a lot of due diligence that still has to be made. But that's a pretty good opportunity if you want to pursue one, is actually, you know, being the aggregator of all these sites and being the definitive source.
Yeah, that would be risky, and it seems like also a big opportunity at the same time. So here's my experience with crowdfunding. I had a project, and here's how, just so you know where I'm coming from. I typically buy, fix, and sell real estate anywhere from, you know, $100,000 retail when it's done up to $350,000, $325,000, $400,000 when it's done. And we're buying that stuff for 65 cents on the dollar. It's pretty cookie cutter real estate investment, single family projects. And we get our funding, I'd say 70% of our funding comes from people who have self-directed IRAs, which were kind of lingering around from the old job that they had 10 years ago, and it was never rolled over. And then they find out they can invest their money in our project, and maybe they have a small IRA, $65,000, which they didn't know they could do something with, and they roll that over to a self-directed IRA. Then I pay them 10, 12% interest while I have their money. It's a simple interest arrangement, but it's relatively difficult to scale that, you know, on some sort of national level. So I'm used to doing deals that way with dormant IRA accounts from old jobs that people had left. That's where most of the funding comes from. So a few years back, you know, crowdfunding was all over Inc. magazine, and it was Business Week, and it was everywhere, and Fortune magazine. I'm reading these articles, and I'm thinking, oh, this is great. We need to find a way to get into this. And there were less of these type of companies, you know, back when I did this research. But even then, sure. David, I felt like I had stepped my toe into a swamp or quicksand. I mean, before I had even begun to do due diligence from a – I would be on the borrower side. I'd be bringing the opportunity to the table. That was kind of the way that I went about approaching the crowdfunding system from the other side, right. Not the guy who has – or the person with the cash, but the person with the opportunity. And it was a quagmire. It just seemed like it was an endless black hole. And I couldn't really get clear answers, and I really didn't know which direction to go in. I couldn't get clear answers as far as the returns or how they're supposed to structure the investment. And as a result of that confusion, I just kind of threw my hands up and said, you know what, this is a bit of a challenge. I mean, aside from that challenge, do you have any enlightenment on other challenges that people would run into, or maybe even success stories that you've had firsthand knowledge of people who have navigated this system, you know,
I just want to make, I want to understand where you were coming from when you reached out to the crowdfunding sites a few years ago. Were you looking to the crowdfunding sites as a opportunity so that you, if you had found a single family home, you would then post it on the site to get investors for, or did you want, or was it something else? Was it the flip of that, which is you wanted to be able to go to the crowdfunding site with the money you had from the IRA and invest in an opportunity?
No, we fund all of our opportunities with IRAs now. So I think I had office building, and it was like a $300,000 to $500,000 deal at the time. It was something commercial, a little bit outside of the box from my normal routine. So that was me going to the crowdfunding, looking for money for my opportunity, as opposed to the flip side.
Got it. So you were looking for money for your opportunity for this building you had. You needed your own investors.
Correct. And I believe a lot of the people who would listen to us on this episode here are going to have that same approach. We have people looking for
excellent.
$6 million for this, $2 million for that, you know, lower amounts, of course. So that, I think that will be a perspective we should definitely touch on.
Yeah, let's talk about that, because that is the quintessential way that a crowdfunding, that a real estate crowdfunding site can help you. So let's take your situation. So you have this building, or you have this home, you're looking for investors, you're looking for people to invest in your opportunity. And I understand that you definitely need some advisement on how to structure the deal, and that's precisely what these crowdfunding sites are for. So before we even get to that, I want you just to realize that, one, you do your due diligence, and let's say you do your due diligence and you find that you want to use iFunding or Realty Mogul or Propeller or Patch of Land. These are some of the bigger real estate crowdfunding sites. You, as the issuer, that's because you're basically going to be issuing some equitable portion of this building or property that you have to potential investors. And so the site today, they will help you structure that deal, but it comes with a price, right? You have to register yourself with that site. And because these sites are SEC approved, you have to be a company, right? You have to be a corporation with the proper disclosures and the proper financials. And, you know, if the SEC is going to allow you to issue shares, if you want to call them, or issue an equitable interest in this property to investors, they want to make sure that you're above the line, right? And so once you go through that whole process of being a SEC-approved company that can now issue investment opportunities to people, these sites then will work with you to structure the deal. But that's not the end of that is not build it and people will come, right? I want to be very clear about the whole crowdfunding opportunity, is that most people forget about the crowd part. Okay, you have the real estate, you put it up there, you did your due diligence, you found the site, you have the property, you went through the SEC hoops, you jumped through all that, you're finally a company that can issue equity, you found the right portal, it's great, they're now helping you structure the deal, or maybe you have to go to an attorney and you have to structure the deal, whatever, maybe went to a bank and you actually structured the deal, you know that you want to collect $500,000 and you want them to be in $5,000 increments, and you want to issue I don't know, 3% equity for each of those shares or for each 5,000 portion or whatever the deal structure is, but you're all set to go and everything is great. Again, that's not the end of it. It's the crowd part that I think most people miss. And so what is ultimately crowdfunding? What are we trying to do? We are trying to get the attention of the crowd. The crowd in this case are the investors. How do you get the investor's attention? How do you get the investor to look at my property? How do you do that? And so this is the same whether you had widget or you had a new pen or you had a new phone or you had some, you know, electrical device that you invented, it's all the same thing. If you have a gorgeous building, or it's going to be a gorgeous building, it's going to be a gorgeous property, it is up to you as the issuer to ensure that you drive traffic, that you create the crowd, that you create the investor pool that and bring them to the portal. That means taking pictures. That means full disclosure. That means creating a social media campaign. That means knocking on people's door in the age of the internet, which is, you know, tweeting and Facebooking and Instagram. You have to build your crowd. You have to build the excitement around your opportunity. And sometimes that means thinking outside the box to get the proper investors. So the investors who are looking at these crowdfunding sites are you know, everybody from the millennials to all the way up to the old to the old time venture capitalists. And they are all looking for a unique opportunity on these sites. But there are hundreds of investment opportunities. There are hundreds of properties on these sites. You need to make sure that you are being noticed. And so I can't stress this enough. One of the take homes is today is that don't forget that this is a new opportunity for you to find investors or vice versa, but it is using the crowd. It is using the power of the internet and social media, and it is driving traffic to you. And this is an odd thing for most people in the real estate industry to adopt. I mean, it's not hard, but for the first timer, it is, because it's doing things a little bit differently, right? The typical real estate transaction deal is I'm calling up my friend, you're calling up your friend, we're meeting at the property, we're wheeling and dealing, we are going to people that we know. But this is different. This is like potentially reaching investors that you may not meet. And the only way you're going to meet them is through this property and through this opportunity that you're presenting, and it should be in this unique way. I want you and your listeners to realize that half the battle is finding the property and the portal, but the second half of the battle is actually bringing the crowd, i.e. the investors, to your opportunity, and then, you know, seeing that all through, right? Issuing the investment, getting the money, and then delivering the ROI when it comes or when the property is sold. So it is a kind of relationship that goes on, and it is a relationship that is playing out in public. It's, again, this is about complete disclosure. So there's a very openness to this whole crowdfunding world. And I mean, I hope that sheds some light on it. I think things have changed since the time that you tried to do it. I think there's a lot of more hand-holding now that the SEC has gotten involved and has mandated certain disclosures. Portals are holding the hands of issuers. They're even holding the hands of investors. They're educating them on the opportunities. They're educating them on how to properly be an SEC-approved company that can issue equity. So I think it's a little bit different landscape. You know, it's definitely more friendly, but without a doubt, it is definitely about the crowd for sure.
Yeah, so in one sense, I guess the crowdfunding platform would differ, say, from me doing direct mail marketing campaigns and having the seminar or the steak dinner at Ruth Chris. It would be almost similar to that, except maybe the crowdfunding platform and site itself provides a slightly better dashboard for both the investors and myself, so that I'm just driving it to that, which adds credibility and also has more disclosure than me standing at the front of the room doing a presentation. Is that kind of the added value of having? Okay.
Yes, and also, Dan, one more thing also, I like the idea of the dashboard. It becomes like an interactive kind of forum for you and your other investors. You know, traditionally, when there is a pool of investors, they normally don't know each other sometimes. And this is a full disclosure. Everybody knows each other. So from that perspective, it's different. Also, a lot of these real estate crowdfunding sites, over the last few years have built relationships with property developers and have now become, you know, somewhat of a, not a gated community, because I don't want to use that terminology, but it's almost as if you join our site and you put your opportunity on our site, you are now open to our investors. You're now open to our properties. You've joined our little group. And so, you know, I think there is some additional benefit to just being associated with a particular site, like Patch of Land or Crowd Street or something like that, some of the bigger ones. So if you can get your project up there and you can get approved by them to put your project up there, that also builds value. That also shows value to the investor.
What would be, because I have a feeling 500,000, there's a certain economy of scale necessary here. And I'm not asking for something, you know, like a legitimate quote, but what would be average or maybe on the low end minimum legal fees to set up, file with the SEC, and maybe the accounting fees? Would you happen to have any insight on that, David?
I do a little bit. Again, these are very general fees, and I'll take it from the small business perspective. I do have some colleagues that are accountants. I do have some colleagues that are SEC corporate attorneys that also, you know, deal with this industry. To really button yourself up, and to ensure that you make the proper financial disclosures, that you've done an audit, that you hire the right attorney, and that they go through all your documentation and have your bylaws and have your offering statements all in order. You know, we're talking, you know, somewhere around, you know, $5,000 to $8,000 to get all that up. That's not terribly expensive. It should be part of the cost of doing business in this field.
And what about on a yearly basis? Is that a yearly fee for a company that's ongoing? $5,000 to $8,000?
No. We're probably talking somewhere in the range of, you know, we're talking about like annual corporate fees to, you know, to the state that you're in. We're talking about tax and audit fees and stuff like that. So maybe the yearly recurring fee is probably in the range of $3,000 to $4,000.
And what would be the smallest deals you've maybe seen or had knowledge of going through? If we're talking an old age home, I imagine that's in the $5, $10 million and up size.
So the smallest deal, we're talking about single family residential homes of around, there are sites out there for about $50,000 or $60,000. If I'm not mistaken, 4 World Trade Center is up on one of these real estate crowdfunding sites, and I think the opportunity is a total of $6 million, and so you can get in for a few hundred thousand to own a piece of 4 World Trade Center.
Interesting.
Yeah. So it really runs the gamut. The interesting opportunity, I think, is for the investor, which is, you know, the investor that has, like you were saying, for your quintessential client, the one that has the IRA money, let's say it does not have a net worth of over $1 million, which is what would have made it an accredited investor back in the day, but now is just somebody that has maybe a little less than that, maybe doesn't work, or maybe does work, maybe makes under $200,000 a year, and these are all kind of limits that I'm mentioning that the SEC has mentioned, and so now this type of person, this non-accredited investor, so somebody who has a net worth of under $1 million that makes less than $100,000 a year, now has the opportunity, if they have some money to invest in, to take, you know, $5,000 or $10,000 and invest in a real estate transaction. That's a whole new world. That's definitely a whole new world for them, especially the ones that are like looking to get involved and, you know, maybe want to get their feet wet, you know, can't really afford their own, you know, property to remodel and renovate, but really want to be a part of the action. And so this is an interesting opportunity. But those investors need to be reached is the point. They don't. So many of these investors don't even know this opportunity exists. And so how do you find them? That's when the crowd has to come in. That's when your social media print has to come in. That's when you have to really go out and network in the internet world. And so how do you do that? Unfortunately, it's with these – I'm saying unfortunately because I'm not from that world either. I'm 42 years old, but that's kind of what it means. It means going out on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and, yes, holding presentations. And, you know, that's also good. There's actually nothing that beats that. But there really is, you know, trying to create this buzz for your crowd so you can one day reach that investor that has that $5,000 or $10,000 that is looking for an opportunity.
Makes sense. So at this point, David, yep. I want to shift gears one more time, and I know you have a lot of different perspective that may not be real estate related and along the same line of thinking that I've kind of steered our conversation so far. And we do have mostly a real estate crowd, but there are some, I'm sure, business owners and things and other people who will use real estate as their jumping off platform to get into other businesses. So I do want to open up the floor and give you free rein for the next few minutes here to talk about challenges and maybe some other insights that would be important for other entrepreneurs, not necessarily crowdfunding related, and just share, you know, a few of your pieces of insight that I'm not capable of asking the right question. Does that sound fair?
Dan. Yeah, Dan, that's very nice of you. Thank you for that. I appreciate that. It is also related to real estate crowdfunding. And I think there's some of your listeners probably saying, so what's the intellectual property angle here? And I'll talk about that for a minute. So basically, when anyone posts a crowdfunding campaign, whether that be real estate or whether that be some widget on Kickstarter, it's very important that they realize that the opportunity that they are putting out there to the world on this dashboard or through this crowdfunding portal needs to meet all the bells and whistles of intellectual property. So what do I mean by that? If you're a company and you have a brand name for your company, or you have a brand name for your product, and you as a company with your brand name are posting this property out there, or you as a brand name are posting your product and calling it X, then you have to have some sort of trademark rights. And so trademarks is a form of intellectual property. It is the form of intellectual property that if you're selling a good or a service, and so property, a building is, or selling a building is a service that would be trademarked, as is a product, you need to make sure that you have your proper protections in place. So that means filing a federal trademark registration. So making sure that your company is not named Google, right? Because Google's not going to like that. And so these sites are not really asking people whether they are doing this or not, which is why we found as intellectual property attorneys, it is our duty to inform people that if you want to use crowdfunding, whether it's real estate or Kickstarter or whatever, that you must have your trademark on file. You must be registered to be doing business in a state, and you must have your trademark on file that's not conflicting with others. Because if, God forbid, your named company was out there for everybody to see, and it turned out that you were infringing somebody else's trademark, and that person informed the crowdfunding portal, the crowdfunding portal is going to take you down mid-project, and that would be disastrous. If you are Realty X and you're selling and you're trying to get investors for a $500,000 building, and your Realty X logo is up there, because it has to be, everybody has to know who they're investing in, and then somebody comes along and sends a letter to the crowdfunding portal and you saying that you're infringing my trademark, they will take that project down midway. That's in their terms of service. So you do not want that to happen. You want to be able to protect your brand from those types of situations. So that's where the intellectual property aspect comes in, and that's why I think it's important to educate and empower people on that. And then from an entrepreneurial perspective, it's the same thing with a patent. If you have an idea for a product and you're putting that product out on one of these crowdfunding sites, it's important that you've done your due diligence to see if somebody has already made that product, maybe so that you're not infringing somebody's patent. Like, that would be disastrous. You're trying to collect $50,000 to make this product, and this product is already out there protected by a patent. Not good. So if you go to an intellectual property attorney before you disclose your products, before you put your name out there, that is only going to help you. That is part of the due diligence. So securing your own intellectual property, whether it's a patent or a trademark, and sometimes even copyright, in the actual images you use, that is essential, an essential part to this crowdfunding world, because the portals will take you down. They don't care about intellectual property as much as we do or as much as I do. They are assuming that you're going to take care of it. So that's kind of the intellectual property angle in all this, and it's an important part, and it actually applies to the real estate crowdfunding world also. You know, every single company is named something. Sometimes the pictures that people use for the properties that they're posting may not be owned by you, right? You may be taking it from the property manager's site or something like that. That might be a no-no. If you don't have the rights to use those photos investment opportunity crowdfunding site, then again, it may be taken down. So please do your intellectual property due diligence before you post any type of campaign. It's not expensive to do this. We're talking about in the range of, you know, a few hundred dollars. That's where they kind of intersect. So thank you for letting me for letting me bridge that for a minute. Thanks so much.
I appreciate that, because I, like I said, I would not have known to ask, and I don't think anybody listening would have known to ask or assume to have this in-depth perspective on the intellectual property aspect of crowdfunding. So I thank you for bringing this to our attention, David. So I'd like to ask for three book recommendations at this point, David, and I'm not sure. Well, we have a real estate related audience. You're coming from the crowdfunding perspective. So what three books would come to mind that would be of value to our listeners?
So yeah, I've been thinking about this for a little bit, because I wanted, you know, and in light of the question you asked about there not being a definitive source of kind of information, and not wanting your listeners to step into the mud the way you did a few years ago, I wanted to make sure that I was recommending books that I find are really kind of on point with what we're talking about. So first one, Crowdfunding Real Estate. I mean, you can't get any clearer than that. It's by Craig Turnbull, Turn and Bull, like Turn the Key and Bull the Animal, Craig Turnbull. It recently came out. It is really the definitive new source to property investing using crowdfunding. It really has a lot of good nuggets. He has a lot of experience as a real estate developer. He also had to change his way of, you know, doing business. He had to, you know, meet the internet. And so this is an interesting take on it all, and a really good read. The second one is just a little bit about crowdfunding. I find it to be also not just about real estate crowdfunding, but it's called The Crowdfunding Revolution: Social Networking Meets Venture Financing. Also, a really good read on, you know, what everything means. I mean, it's so easy to like Google something and get a Wikipedia kind of definition on something, but that's not really the way you want to learn something. You really want to learn from the practical applications of it, and you want to learn from real life experiences. And so this book, written by Kevin Lawton, really good read to, again, The Crowdfunding Revolution: Social Networking Meets Venture Financing. That's really what it's about. That social aspect, that social networking aspect, is so key in the crowdfunding world. So you have to really get comfortable with that part of it if you want to be in the crowdfunding world, especially in the real estate crowdfunding world. The last one, just because I tend to get very drawn to entrepreneurial books, and if you get to know me, you know that I'm now having my entrepreneurial moment, being that I've left large firm life and now at a small firm, and, you know, really trying to be, you know, high value, low price for entrepreneurs. It's important that I think the entrepreneur understands a little bit about what it means to be an entrepreneur. And so Guy Kawasaki, phenomenal author, phenomenal entrepreneur. He's written, you know, 8 or 9 books. Any single one of them is great. Anything by Guy Kawasaki. So The Art of Social Media, Reality Check, Selling the Dream. I was never this type of person to follow other entrepreneurs and what they said, but he has really, he has an amazing library of books. And so, yeah, so those three.
Great recommendations there. I know I'll be ordering those as soon as we'll wrap up here. Do you have any final jewels of wisdom that you'd like to share with our listeners, David?
Yeah, so, you know, I just wanted to say that this world of crowdfunding is definitely a phenomenal world to be a part of. There's a lot of opportunity, a lot of money to be made, but it is really brand new. It really is in its infancy. And so with anything that's new, there is an influx of platforms out there. And so please do your due diligence. Make sure you really understand who you're getting into bed with, who you're signing up with, and hopefully that will be okay. At the end of the day, the other kind of nugget that I want to just throw out there is that I think you have to, and you probably heard this maybe from your previous speakers, you have to really be prepared for failure sometimes, right? So failure breeds success. It's what entrepreneurs and what people are made of sometimes. And so it's okay to have failure. And in this new world of real estate crowdfunding, there will likely be some of that. All these portals will likely, you know, drip away and the cream will rise to the top. And so yes, you might be an early adopter and you might prevail in that sense. Hopefully, having done your due diligence, you have married the right person and, you know, been in bed with the right portal that actually outlasts this influx of many portals out there. So as long as you're comfortable with some failure, I think you'll be okay. Other than that, I'm a big believer in first give before you can get type of thing. I kind of live that every day. So give before you can get.
Nice. Great points. Care to share your contact info, David?
Yes, I'm local to the state of New Jersey. We have offices here in New Jersey, New York, and Philadelphia. So we're in Summit. My email is david@gearheartlaw.com. Very simple, gear, like gear shift, heart without the E, law.com. I'm pretty much available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and I know I'll probably regret this, but actually I probably won't. But you can even reach me on my cell. I'm pretty approachable. Well, don't charge by the hour or the minute or anything like that, and be happy to answer any questions. So my number is 646-644-2959. I think it's important to be available, and so I make that available and have not regretted it yet. So thank you for allowing me to do that.
All right. I appreciate you coming on the show. I've got a ton of information here myself. I'm sure everybody listening does as well. So I thank you for giving of your time here to come on the REI Diamond Show. It's a great episode.
Great. Thank you so much. It was great having you. I love everything you do. So I'm excited to see what comes next.
Nice. And to you, my loyal listener, thank you for continuing to tune in to the REI Diamond Show. If you know anyone else who might enjoy or get some value from this episode, send them a link. You can also sign up to receive new episode notifications at www.reidiamonds.com. And as a bonus for signing up, I'll send you my special report titled 7 Sources of Off-Market Deals. There's also a public relations link on that page for those interested in applying to come on the show as an expert guest. The website, again, is www.reidiamonds.com. Thanks again for listening. Dan Breslin here. I'll catch you next time. Remember, here at the REI Diamond Show, we're dedicated to increasing, multiplying, and protecting your net worth.
Thanks for listening to the REI Diamond Interview. To receive the REI Diamonds newsletter and interview monthly, sign up now at www.reidiamonds.com.